be seated. In our offerings today, we remember ancestors who refused to allow social taboos or the risk of judgment to keep them from showing great love. Faithful acts of loving generosity inspire us. Let us demonstrate extravagant faith without counting the cost. The morning offering will now be received. Gracious God, we offer our gifts as an act of extravagant faith. Bless this offering that it might be a witness to your realm of forgiveness, justice, and healing. May this act of sharing embolden us to show great generosity in our lives. It is in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Today's New Testament reading tells a familiar story of a woman anointing Jesus with costly ointment while he is attending a dinner. The intriguing aspect of today's reading is that it is very early in Luke's gospel, at the beginning of Jesus' ministry. We most often hear this story in conjunction with Jesus' journey to Jerusalem just before his death and resurrection. Matthew's gospel recounts this event in its 26th chapter, Mark's in the 14th chapter, and John tells this story in the 12th chapter of his gospel. We are reminded here in Luke's gospel of Jesus' willingness to gather at the table with anyone, regardless of their status, as well as his expansive forgiveness, which is offered to all. Hear now the gospel according to Luke, chapter 7, verses 36 through 50. One of the Pharisees asked Jesus to eat with him, and he went into the Pharisee's house and took his place at the table. And a woman in the city who was a sinner, having learned that he was eating in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster jar of ointment. She stood behind him at his feet, weeping, and began to bathe his feet with her tears and to dry them with her hair. Then she continued kissing his feet and anointing them with the ointment. Now when the Pharisee who had invited him saw it, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would have known who and what kind of woman this is who is touching him, that she is a sinner." Jesus spoke up and said to him, "Simon, I have something to say to you." "Teacher," he replied, "speak." A certain creditor had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii and the other 50. When they could not pay, he canceled the debts for both of them. "Now which of them will love him more?" Simon answered, "I suppose the one for whom he canceled the greater debt." And Jesus said to him, "You have judged rightly." Then turning toward the woman, he said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has bathed my feet with her tears and dried them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but from the time I came in, she has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she has anointed my feet with ointment. Therefore, I tell you, her sins, which were many, have been forgiven. Hence, she has shown great love. But the one to whom little is forgiven loves little." Then he said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." But those who were at the table with him began to say among themselves, "Who is this who forgives sins?" And he said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." Here ends the reading of God's holy word. May he add to our hearing and understanding his blessings. Amen. Please pray with me. God of compassion, you suffer in the grief of your people and you are present to heal and forgive. May the sun of your justice rise on every night of oppression, and may the warm rays of your healing love renew each troubled mind. For you are the God of salvation and new life, made known to us in Jesus Christ our Lord. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. Do you know what a scoopaloon is? It's an Italian word, probably slang, for a punishing blow across the face with the back of the hand. It could perhaps be characterized as an obedience strategy used by parents at a time when striking a child seemed like an effective response to bad behavior. My grandparents on the Italian side were scoopaloon types. Joe grew up in a scoopaloon family. But my father, perhaps as a result of having been raised in a scoopaloon family, never lifted a hand to my sisters and I. Never raised a hand. In many ways, the God of the Old Testament is a scoopaloon type of God. In ancient times, there was a strong belief that sinning resulted in the wrath of God. God expected people to behave and to follow the commandments, and when they strayed, punishment was inevitable. It was a cultural mindset. Today's Old Testament reading is an illustration of this godly power. The passage that we heard Carol read is a litany of bad behavior. We are faced with David, a man of wealth and power, manipulating the life and death of Uriah so that he can gain possession of Uriah's wife, Bathsheba. There are so many sins in this story that it's hard to point to just one. David's manipulation for his own satisfaction affects countless lives, his own, Uriah's, Bathsheba's, her child, the person responsible for setting up Uriah's death, and future generations that incur punishment for David's sins. This is the problem with sinning. It never just affects the sinner. It always has a ripple effect. David, who perhaps deserves a heavenly scoopaloon, is punished with the death of his yet-to-be-born child, conceived with Bathsheba, or recently born child, conceived with Bathsheba. And again, this ripple effect, Bathsheba loses her new child, and her child punished for David's sin. Nathan the prophet, chosen by God to speak truth to power, cleverly points out to David the nature of his actions. And David, recognizing his wrongdoing, at Nathan's strong words, "You are that man," David repents and he begs forgiveness from the Lord. And this is really the suspenseful part of the story. The child is sick for 7 days, and David lays by its side, fasting and praying for recovery. In the passage that comes after what we read today, the child dies. And David returns to his normal routine, explaining that he held out hope in the Lord's intervention, but now that the child has died, there's nothing he can do. In his view, he sinned, he was punished, and now the slate is clean. Bathsheba bears him a second son, whom they name Solomon, which means his replacement. Forgiveness in this cultural mindset was only granted by God when the sinner took responsibility, repented, and sought the Lord's reprieve. Once forgiven, you could start fresh. The psalmist, who is sometimes referenced as King David, sang of the joy of those whose transgressions are forgiven, while lamenting the condition of those who keep their sins to themselves. So now we fast forward to the New Testament, and we find Luke's gospel account of the woman known as a sinner, who ventures into a dinner party to wash Jesus' feet. She anoints him with oil. She honors him. This woman and her sins are unnamed. It's left to our imagination. Her behavior is clearly described, which invites our judgment. What kind of person would walk into someone's house and start washing and perfuming a guest's feet? Well, in biblical times, feet washing was a sign of gracious hospitality. Everyone walked everywhere, and the streets were made of dirt. This story is told to remind us that the Pharisee, the man with power, the host, he did not remember to welcome his guest with a foot wash. But the sinner, the one able to acknowledge the need of God's grace, was willing to take a risk. Her act of humility earned her a blessing and forgiveness from Jesus. She comes to Jesus in love and in brokenness, not in repentance. She comes bestowing honor, not seeking forgiveness. And Jesus believes that her love flows from her being forgiven, not that her love is a requirement which earns her forgiveness. Forgiveness, which is based on the need for evidence of repentance, is exactly what Jesus rejected. The Pharisees ask, "Who is this who forgives sins?" To forgive sin was strictly the prerogative of God. And Jesus was boldly proclaiming a power that was not seen to be within the human realm. The lesson and the gift that we take from this passage is that we, like Jesus, have the power to forgive. For Jesus, forgiveness is contingent on nothing. He chooses to forgive whether the other person repents or not. He offers forgiveness as a gift, freeing those bound by sin for new life. He went to the cross for forgiveness. For each one of us, for every single created being, sinner or not. Our readings today are about a certain type of forgiveness, which is sometimes hard for us to understand. Forgiveness which is seemingly undeserved. I think that David was only sorry because he got caught. My mother used to say that all the time. You're not sorry, you're sorry you got caught. And the unnamed woman doesn't seem to be asking forgiveness. But the power of this undeserved forgiveness is at the heart of our Christian experience. Forgiveness is the mark of those who follow Christ, and it represents one of the biggest challenges to us as we endeavor to live our values every day. Forgiveness is a choice. It is a decision that we can make to let go of the things that we hold against others, and perhaps more importantly, those things that we hold against ourselves. Failing to forgive stifles our ability to exist, to know grace, and most importantly, to understand the magnitude of God's grace. So many of the grudges and the sins that we refuse to forgive in ourselves and others are trivial. Yet our refusal to let go can damage our ability to understand that we are beloved by God, forgiven by God, and that the power of God's grace working in our lives. By refusing to trust that God is gracious to us, We are limiting our ability to be gracious to other people. So the Pharisees ask, "Who is this that even forgives sin?" It is Christ. It is the Son of God. He forgives us so that we can forgive others and ourselves. What a gift. Forgiveness encompasses all the virtues that we have been looking at in this study of living our values. Compassion, truth, trust, love, faith, hope, and humility. All of these virtues and values that we've been studying, all of these go into the act of forgiveness. We had a lot of conversation last week about what our church motto should be. Perhaps our church motto should be forgiven and forgiving. In closing, I want to share a poem by John Vondelaar titled Grace and Forgiveness. It is not a perfect life we live, O God. We are people of ambivalent goodness and two fragile desires for justice and righteousness. We need your grace and forgiveness and your strength to bring grace into the world. It's not a perfect world we live in, O God. There is greed and want, exploitation and marginalization, and too many people excluded for indefensible reasons. We need your grace and forgiveness and your strength to bring grace into the world. Remind us, O God, that it is not perfection you seek, but humility, brokenness, and repentance. Lead us into a love for you that is reckless and selfless, that because we have been forgiven much, we will risk everything for you, washing your feet and those of the poor and suffering, weeping with you and those who grieve, standing with the rejected and mocked, even as we share their lot. We need your grace and forgiveness and your strength to bring grace into the world. Let us pray for the grace to be forgiven and forgiving people. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we turn to you seeking your unending compassion and love. We ask that you forgive us our weaknesses and grant us the strength to forgive those who are in need of our gifts. Help us to be virtuous followers of your word, people of strong moral character and unending compassion. Be with us, God, as we journey through this life, encountering all different types of people along the way. Let us be the ones with open arms and open hearts conveying your power and glory to those we meet. Hear us this day as we pray for those whom we love. We pray for Teresa, for Dick, for Don and Gloria, for Alvord, for Kit and Bob, for Barbara, Sarah, Mark and Claude, Becky, Lucille, Peter, Michelle, Warren, Jane, and Mike. May your healing touch be upon each one. We pray for those who grieve that our love might ease their pain, especially this day for Hal Lefferts and their family. We pray for our brothers and sisters throughout the world who live with hunger and violence and fear. May they know your presence and feel our compassion. We thank you for our fathers and their presence in our lives, and we pray for peace in our hearts, in our homes, and in your world. Hear us now as we turn to you in the sacred silence of this meeting house with the prayers of our hearts. Jesus taught them to pray together in these words, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now, my friends, go forth from this place, responding to the witness of the prophet Nathan and the woman who anointed Jesus. Name injustice when you see it. Speak truth to power when it's needed. Show great love even when it's very risky. Take refuge in God when you get lonely or scared. And may the blessings of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you this day and forevermore. Amen.